Welcome to Gina's Natural Way. So on today, we're moving on. If this is your first time tuning in, we have a book club called Gina's Book Club. I'll leave a link in the description box, and it's just for godly women or women who want to better their lives, better their prayer lives, just better themselves all around. And so we're working on our first book, which is Fervent by Priscilla Schreier. I'll leave a link in the description box if you want to purchase the book and all that good stuff. We do war binders, the war journals, and then I'll leave a link to that because I did a video on how to set that up. So you guys can go back and check all of that because we are moving on, you guys. We are on strategy one, which is talking about your passion. All right, so we're going to go ahead and get right into it. It says, getting it back when it's gone. If I were your enemy, I'd seek to dim your passion, dull your interest in spiritual things, dampen your belief in God's ability and his personal concern for you, and convince you that the hope you've lost is never coming back and was probably just a lie to begin with. Significantly lower your resistance to temptation and discouragement. I can make you walk with a spiritual limp and lengthen how long it takes you to recover from the injury. If I could chip away at your zeal, at your hope, at your belief in God and what he can do, I could chisel down your faith to a whimper, make you want to quit and never try again. I'd cup an ear in your direction and hear nothing in your voice that sounds like anything but token prayer and snicker at my success. Chalk another one up by my passion elimination plan, the one with your name on it. That's what I'd do if I was your enemy. This is good because so many people have been sharing on the Facebook group and emailing me and everything and telling me that, you know, these are some of the things that's happened to them. And so they're happy to be back on track and to see the enemy, know the enemy, and trying to get their life back. So this is definitely right on point. That's what I'd do if I were your enemy. I'd weaken your passion, your cutting edge, knowing full well that weak, impotent prayers, or better yet, prayerlessness will follow right behind. And that is definitely the truth, because a lot of people don't really have a prayer life. And like I was sharing before, that's your communication with God and Jesus. So if you don't have a prayer life, you really don't have too much. Like, the devil can do what he wants to you and take you in any direction because you're not praying. And so this is really good. So it says, take a long, hard, deep look at yourself and answer this question. Have you lost your passion? Has your get up and go simply gotten up and gone? Maybe you've prayed and prayed for the same thing over and over. Maybe you've wanted God's will so bad and wanted life to look different for so long. Maybe you're feeling utterly discouraged or disappointed right now and not sure why you keep being surprised every time the same old things keep happening again and again. Maybe other demands and distractions have leaked into your heart over time, crowding out space where older, nobler priorities once ruled. I get all of that. I've felt a lot of that. But what makes you think it's somehow all God's fault, or your fault, or everybody else's fault, but never the enemy's fault? Why aren't we equally as quick to recognize the telltale marks of his darkened ideas and initiative? When you can't seem to respond to spiritual stimuli with the same optimism and obedience as you once did, why do you think it could be only attributed to your bad character, to a drop in your hormone level, or to the normal deterioration that comes from age and accumulated adversity? Maybe another less noticeable but equally probable reason is that you've been a victim of satanic sabotage. It's a strategy against you on your purpose, an assaulted lunch with pinpoint planning and detail. I mean, think about it. Doesn't it fit the profile? Satan is a full-time accuser. He does it day and night. The Bible says, Revelation 12 and 10, instead of convicting you for the purpose of restoration, as God's spirit does, he condemns you for the purpose of destroying, humiliating. This pattern, by the way, is classic proof of the enemy's influence. Watch for it and note his fingerprints. Condemnation always leads to guilt-laden discouragement, while conviction though awful, painful in pointing out our wrongdoing, still somehow encourages and lifts us up, giving us hope to rebuild on. The first makes your focus on yourself. The other points you to the grace and empower mercy of Christ. To hear the devil tell it, these weaknesses of yours are reason for nothing but wretched despair. Yet God says, those same weaknesses are reason for your purest worship and gratitude. Your need for God's grace is supposed to be a passion enhancer. Now that's the opposite of what takes place. However, as soon as you start believing the enemy's accusations, he'll make you think God doesn't hear you from your prayers or respond to them. Why? Because of you. How typical. Because Satan, in addition to being an accuser, is also a confirmed liar. No, worse, he's the father of lies. John 8:44 says he's the granddaddy of all truth. Deception is the overarching umbrella that encompasses all his plans and programs. He warps your perspective on the current events in your life until reality appears much worse and more desperate than it truly is. Now that's good, because can you guys, you know, you start, sometimes it could be something in your life and all of a sudden it turns into a big thing. Like it'll be something small in your head, but then you'll keep replaying it over and over and over, and it turns huge. And it's like, oh my gosh, when it's really not that big of a deal. It's just the devil. Since I'm not saying the situation is not legitimately bad, perhaps it is painful beyond description, but through his lying eyes, any passion for perseverance seems like a silly, sentimental waste of time. And yet he has the gall to insinuate that God is the one who lies to you, that any delay of the Lord's visible response to your prayer is open and shut evidence that he doesn't really hear you, like he says, or if he does, he apparently doesn't mind seeing you writhe in discomfort while you wait on his own sweet timing. Such biting accusations against you, against God, such bitter lies about what's taking place. Those are just some of the ways he tries to eat away at your passion. Not overtly and conspicuously, he's much too crafty for that, but cunningly, slowly, incrementally, over time. And sometimes he gets us. We don't recognize it's him at first, working behind the scenes. We think the reason we've stopped praying is because, oh, we just don't feel like it anymore. How many times have we said that, you guys? How many times are we just like, oh God, we don't feel like praying, or we don't feel like, look, we think it's just us. And sure, maybe that's the way it really is. But possibly this lack of feeling is a clue that the enemy's strategy has begun to take effect. He's worked you down enough until you can't seem to muster up the will to begin to fight back, to keep believing for and praying about your marriage still hopeless and tense and broken, your child still rebelling against all sound logic, your money, you still don't have enough. Your addiction still defeating the way too often. You just can't seem to bring these up to God anymore because there doesn't seem to be any spiritual fire burning on the inside. Maybe even right now, even while you're reading this book, that's inviting you back where you once walked, back to fervent believing prayer. You honestly just don't see the point in going there again. So here's what I say to you. Let's start here. Praying for this, to recover and maintain your passion, to regain your sustain, your cutting edge. In order to do it, I want you to take back to a real life story that God placed in scriptures, 2 Kings 6:1-7, for just a moment as this. And I want to use it and the principle it teaches to encourage your heart and then help you begin stirring up a strategy to get your passion back. Because if you're not at a low passion point right now, the time will likely come when you'll feel yourself being tugged there, because it's going to happen, you guys. If you're not there, believe me, it happened to me. It happened to everybody, you guys. And when that season comes, make a note to put this story on your must-read list. As it happened, the prophet Elisha was standing near one of his proteges, who was chopping down a tree at the banks of the Jordan River, laboring together the raw materials needed for building a larger meeting place. But at one point, he either an upswing or a downswing, the iron head of that man's axe wiggled loose from his wooden handle and sailed into the water, plopping to the bottom, splash, gasp. And just like that, he'd lost his cutting edge. The young prophet was horrified. And not only had he lost the tool on one hand, the most important tool in the toolbox for him, moving forward towards the outcome he desired, but the axe he'd been using had he borrowed from a friend. The kerplunker of that dead weight in the water was a double whammy of disappointment and disgust. He couldn't go forward with this project. And now he needs to go to the person who loaned him the axe and tell him what happened to it, that he broke it, he lost it, and that there was no getting it back. Now notice, though, these encouraging details from the story. Number one, despite the lost axe head, the presence of God was still near. In ancient Israel, Yahweh's prophets were representations of his presence and power with his people. So when the man in the story lost the axe head, the fact that the prophet Elisha was right there alongside with him, verse 3, wasn't just a simple comfort. It mattered that Elisha had seen how hard this man had worked, all the trees he chopped down, and how his cutting edge had been lost. It mattered that God's presence and the man's loss occurred within close proximity of the other. Satan would like to convince you that your lack of passion is an indication that God has either never there or at all, or has got disgusted with you and left. He wants you to believe that God has not seen your struggle and is unaware or disinterested in the details of your life. But just because you're feeling at a loss for words and want to, just because your cutting edge in prayer seems misplaced for now, does not mean that God isn't close by. And that's true. If you heard the first video of the fervent that I put, I talked about my testimony, how I went through so much stuff and I thought God don't love me, or God wasn't, he wasn't there. I mean, that's how I felt. So that is definitely the truth. Satan wants you to think that, you know. It says number two, the servant was doing something good when he lost his cutting edge. He was being productive. He was building a new dwelling for himself. So y'all, he was working. He wasn't just sitting down. When he was doing that, he was being busy. And then the devil came at him like that. It says, and for those that had been involved in the school of the prophets. In fact, if he hadn't been working so hard, if he'd just been sitting around doing nothing, then there's little chance that the axe would have ever become gradually loosened and ultimately dislodged. This tells me that being engaged in good, even godly, productive things is not an automatic guard against your losing your cutting edge. In fact, one of Satan's dirtiest little tactics is to sneak in and steal it while you're square in the middle of investing yourself in worthwhile activities. That's why when you're sensing a dragon in your faith, in your spiritual fire, it can sometimes simply mean you're doing exactly what you're supposed to do and doing it well. Number three, the axe was borrowed. The presence of passion, faith, and belief in our hearts is a gift. It's on loan to our souls, like the man's axe. Our passion and spiritual fervor come from someone else as a gift to us. If you've ever cried out passionately to God in faith, fully believing that he is able to do more than you ask or think or imagine, it's only because he first stirred up that passion within you. So instead of always feeling guilty, personally responsible, whenever your passion and prayer is weak or missing, realize instead that it is God's work both to give it and then to fan it and into you and flame inside of you, which means you can't manufacture it on your own. Your enemy, however, coy as he is, wants to burden you with blame for not having something that you didn't originate with in the first place. Don't fall for that. Number four, only a work of God could retrieve the axe head. So where did it fall? The man of God asked. When he showed him the place, Elisha cut a stick and threw it into the water of that spot. Then the axe head floated to the surface. Miraculously, by Elisha's hand, the slab of iron rustled free from the murky riverbed and bobbed up the surface as if it was nothing but a floating chunk of driftwood. And there it was. His cutting edge was back, divinely recovered. Elisha's servant had understandably been convinced that there was no hope of ever seeing it again. And there wouldn't have been, except that he went to Elisha and God, through the prophet, stepped in and made it reappear. If the axe head had just dropped to the ground, anybody who saw where it went, including the man himself, he could have just picked it up and salvaged it, but instead it went to the deep river and only a miracle could get it back. Just like you might need a miracle to get yours back too, if it's sunk to the bottom. like everyone's passion for prayer has done at one time or another. But listen to me, nothing is too far gone that God cannot resurrect it. Don't even your cutting edge. So go to him to get it back. Don't try to regain it yourself. Don't set your hopes on other people or circumstance to fuse it back into the fire of being, but trust it into God's care. Only his miraculous work can make it bubble back up to the surface where it belongs. And he is more than willing to do that. Call to prayer. So before we go, before we tackle and craft prayer strategies for the 9 other topics in this book, the seminal matter of getting and maintaining our cutting edge so that we ever even want to pray again is foundational. But when we talk about passion in prayer, I sure don't want to leave the impression that the only prayer God hears is that kind that's spoken in a high volume with sweat and tears and shaking fists and extraordinary energy. Prayer can be silent and still seethed with passion. And on some days, and sometimes, prayer for any of us can start out simply as an obedient appointment, an act of discipline, just showing up in the prayer closet because it's the appointed time that we said we'd be there. Because praying, reaching outward and upward to him is the way his passion comes down. Even prayers that begin with the blunt edge of willpower, dragging your heart along, kicking and screaming, can soon begin to shine with the cutting edge of hope, faith, and passionate confidence in Christ. Once the wind of God's Spirit starts blowing, you're no longer praying rote, innocuous prayers. Instead, you're praying deliberate prayers, prayers that are personalized and devastating as the enemy's attacks against you. Strategic power. Strategic prayers, powerful prayers, prayers that tell the enemy his cover has been blown, his number has come up, and his game is down. Prayers built up on promises of God that entreat him to give you back what he was responsible for giving you in the first place. Infuse your first prayer strategy with passages and promises like these. Psalms 51 and 10, and I'll put these on the, in case you don't have the book, I'll put it in the book club so you know these. But it says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. The Lord's loving kindness indeed never ceases, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Another one is, I will give them a heart to know me, for I am the Lord, and they will be my people, and I will be their God, for they will return to me with their whole heart. Another one, call upon me and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Jeremiah 29 and 12. Now, you know how I also did another video where I was saying sometime you can pray scriptures and you should put the scriptures in your prayer book. So if you're new to praying or you want God to just clean your heart out, these are really good scriptures. All you have to do is just remind God of his word. And that's a prayer within itself. And read the scripture. So you could say, just like in Deuteronomy 30 and 6, it says, the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul so that you may live. And then there's a few more. It says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And then this last one, it says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And it says, don't read that last one too quickly, okay? One more time, slowly and deliberately, like how you sip a glass of sweet tea on a blazing hot summer day, wanting the refreshment to last. So that's Ezekiel 36 and 26. Let's do it nice and slow. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. Do you see the promises I will give you? I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart that's alive and tender again, one that's beating and responsive again, engaged again, and able to believe again. A prayer that's seeking passion should not be about manufacturing a better feeling or jostling up a better mood. It's simply about holding out your hands in thanksgiving and gratitude for God's faithfulness and his goodness and his assured accomplishment victory over the enemy. Then asking for what he already wants to give to you. then waiting and expecting to receive the promises of His newness and freshness from His Spirit as you go along. More each day, praying as the prophet Hosea said, He will come to us like the rain, like the spring rain watering the earth. How does a person receive the rain? Not by prying it loose from the sky, but just by watching it fall. Isn't that beautiful, you guys? By standing in the downpour, by thanking Him for opening up the floodgates and sending what He knows we need and can't get for ourselves. Yet what He is so faithfully, regularly, and graciously just gives. Let's get going with just these few little verses to get you started. Grab a pen, flip to the pages for prayer in the back of the book, and write down your own prayer strategy for passion, a prayer for God to help you maintain it, if it's good, or regain it if it's gone, and make it part of a praise, part of repentance, part of asking, and a whole lot of yes. But don't just read the words you've crafted, pray them. And no matter if your writing is short, long, or somewhere in between, pray it as for the steady, fervent prayers of your will, in anticipation of seeing it become the burning desire of your heart, because it's not just another do better in your list of New Year's resolution. It's a prayer strategy, and that's what makes it work. So that is strategy number one. That is awesome. So what we're doing, we're getting our passion back. We're going to take verses, like she said, and turn them into prayer requests. And when you're praying, you want to be able to feel it. And it might be a little bit hard at first, but you want to make sure that you can maybe even put on this little music, a little relaxing music, where you can just kind of get in the mood and open up your spirit. And as you begin to pray these words, I mean, this is so beautiful. Like, you can pray. This is how they're saying to pray. All you got to do is say, God, you said in Ezekiel 36 and 26, I will give you a new heart. You said you were going to put a new spirit within me. You said you would remove your heart of stone and give me a heart of flesh. Now give it to me, Lord God. God, I want this new heart. I want you to remove the stone. You can just begin to pray, and just like that, if God said it, He's going to do it, because it is in His word. It is His Bible. He will do it. So all you have to do is put Him in remembrance of your word. So what we're going to do, you guys, every week I like to discuss a little bit of the book. So you're going to meet me over on Facebook on the book club. And the question for this week, what I'm going to ask you guys is, which scripture are you going to use for your prayer? Because there's a lot of, you don't have to use just hers too. There's a lot of them that you could talk about getting your passion back, or your heart, or renewing your heart. And I just want you to write in that box your favorite scripture. If you don't have Facebook, that's okay. Go ahead and just write it in the comment section here. Your favorite scripture, something that really touches your heart, that you want to pray to God to open up your heart, because this is very beautiful. And sometime, I will share this really quick testimony. Sometimes your heart is hard. I know I had, for the longest time, because just growing up, I had developed a very hard heart, and it was like nobody was going to hurt me. I was going to hurt you first. And so because I was so hardcore, so mean to everybody. I mean, I was just very mean, very just not a nice person growing up, because I was mad. And so because of how hard I was, it was so hard for me to get close to God. I would see people in church and they'd be praying and crying and jumping around, and I would think to myself, they're just faking. You know, I thought, do they really feel anything? Because I couldn't feel anything. But I had to learn that it was just me. It was just because God had to soften my heart. And after I went through all my trials, all my tribulations, then God began to literally break me down. So sometimes we go through things, we don't know why. Sometimes it's just for God to break us down so He can build us up all again. And I tell you what, I am a new person. I am a new creature in Christ. I don't even know myself back then, because like we're talking years ago though, but when you look at me, it's like, oh my gosh, like I was so mean. And my family still is like, oh wait, you can't mess with her, because if you say this, she's going to go off. I mean, I was that person that will go off in the store. I will go off in a restaurant. I was just mean and evil, and God had to totally renew me. So this is beautiful. We want to pray these things. And just like she said, just know that the devil is not going to take, he's going to be mad. He's going to be mad because y'all starting to stir things up. Y'all starting to take control of your life. So know that things is going to happen. And when it does, you say, oh, devil, that's just you. And keep right on praying. Keep right on going. Don't entertain him. Don't just start crying and getting all upset. No, devil, that's just you. You better get somewhere. God said, I bind whatever we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. I rebuke you and send him back where he needs to go. And y'all keep going on with y'all day. So with that being said, you guys, I love y'all. I will see y'all in the next video. I'll see you over on the book club, and I will see you all next Wednesday. Bye, guys.